Here the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
Difficulties of today and tomorrow.
I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up
and live out the true meaning of its creed.
We hold these truths to be self-evident,
that all men are created equal.
I have a dream that one day on the Red Hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slaves' owners will be able to sit together at the table of brotherhood.
I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi,
a state sweltering with the heat
of injustice,
sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice.
I have a dream that little children
will one day live in a nation
where they will not be judged
by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character.
I have a dream today.
I have a dream that
one day, right there in Alabama,
little black boys and little black girls will be able to join hands
with little white boys and white girls
as sisters
and brothers. I have a dream today.
This is our hope. This is the faith I go back to the mountain with. With this faith,
we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope.
With this faith, we'll be able to transform the genuine discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood.
With this faith, we will be able to work together,
pray together,
to struggle together,
go to jail together, to stand up for freedom forever,
knowing that we will be free one day.
And I say to you today, my friends, let freedom ring
from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire.
Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York.
Let freedom ring from the mighty Alleghenies of Pennsylvania.
Let freedom ring
from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado.
Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only there, let freedom ring from the Stone Mountain of Georgia.
Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain in Tennessee.
Let freedom ring for every hill and molehill in Mississippi.
From every mountainside, let freedom ring.
When we let it rain from every village and hamlet, every state and every city,
we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black man and white man,
Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics,
will be able to join hands and sing,
in the words of the old Negro spiritual,
free at last!
Free at last!
Thank God Almighty,
we're free at last.
History Month, Saints. My name is Caleb Bahar, and this is a good news announcement for the month of February. Welcome to St. John's United Methodist Church, the church in the heart of Watts with Watts at heart. Happy birthday to all those born in February. We wish you a happy and amazing and blessed.
We are, as a people, you're invited to wear your African or black culture attire throughout the month of February. The United Women in Faith will study and fellowship on Saturday, February 12th at 10 a.m. All women are invited via Zoom call or phone. Contact Helen Ricks or Mary King for more information. Check out the pictures from the United Women in Faith Recreation Sunday.
The speaker was Minister Latonya Cunningham, Sandra Winston, and Mary King, who were recognized and honored among the women for their leadership.
You're going to join the ministry? Join the choir. They're also looking for people who love to sing. Want to dance for the Lord? Join Echoes of Praise Dance Ministry. If you'd like to help with the clothes, see Pastor Samuel. Everyone is invited to join Bible study on Tuesday evening at 7 p.m. on a conference call. See digital flyers for more ministry updates and details.
If you have a ministry announcement or want to highlight a ministry, please contact Trisha Hamilton. Please fill the digital I Am Here attendance and prayer request form each week so that you participate in worship. Scan the QR code with your phone or click the link. We're looking forward to seeing you on Sunday mornings for worship in person or online via YouTube or Facebook. See you next week, Saints, and keep praying.
This is the call to worship. The Holy One is our sovereign. Let us praise God's grace and awesome name. Mighty ruler, lover of justice, you have established fairness among us.
Yeah.
Today's scripture is taken from Romans 2, 1 through 16. Therefore, you have no excuse, whoever you are, when you judge others, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, are doing the very same things. You say, we know that God's judgment on those who do such things is in accordance with truth. Do you imagine, whoever you are, that when you judge those who do such things and yet do them yourself, you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you despise the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience? Do you not realize that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But by your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgments will be revealed. For he will repay according to each one's deeds. To those who by patiently doing good seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. While for those who are seeking and who obey not the truth but wickedness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be anguish and distress for anyone who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek, but glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good. The Jew first and also the Greek, for God shows no partiality. All who have sinned apart from the law will also perish apart from the law. And all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. For it is not the hearers of the law who are righteous in God's sight, but the doers of the law who will be justified. When Gentiles who do not possess the law do instinctively what the law requires, these, though not having the law, are a law to themselves. They show that what the law requires is written in their hearts, to which their own conscience also bears witness. And their conflicting thoughts will accuse or perhaps excuse them on the day when, according to my gospel, God, through Jesus Christ, will judge the secret thoughts of all. And that was the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I need your grace. Amen. Good morning. Glad to be here. Thankful to God. And as I was sitting here and as we were all aware, and then as Reverend Kathy made reference about the noise and the sound of what appeared to be distress, initially somebody told me it was a dog, and I was thinking, a dog, okay. I mean, I don't know, maybe that's some a regular occurrence with a particular dog, but I said, okay. But then it started to sound like something different.
Yes.
You know, like
yes.
Someone was really in distress, and we know that Micah asked, I think 6:8, about what does the Lord require of us. Sometimes God requires that we intervene in whatever way we can. Not to go running down the alley with Bibles and purses like we gonna do something like that, but sometimes to pick up the phone and make a phone call, and even sometimes in some of our communities, and that could be anywhere, you know, sometimes you gotta put extras on stuff to get people to show up. Nobody's telling anybody to just flat out lie. But sometimes you actually have to put a few extras for people to understand there's a sense of urgency, or else they'll kind of shake it off because they're a little jaded about what things mean. So that's also just a word of a reminder that sometimes we have to do that. We have to put extras on some things. And so I am thankful and I am grateful that Reverend Kathy asked me to speak. And I will say that anyone should consider it an honor if you're a decent pastor, because folk don't just have everybody up in their pulpit.
Amen.
Or you shouldn't.
Amen.
You know, you need, you can't be turning this loose. You know, it's like loaning your car or money to just anybody. Discerning, as we say in that. And so this morning the scripture has been read, and I will be referencing some of that. But as we are in Black History Month, you know, we need to just be reminded that we have some people who have done great and mighty things through Christ Jesus. And I think we ought to always be reminded that, at least for our conference, did a great and mighty thing for Reverend Kathy Michelle, Reverend Dr. Kathy Michelle Wilborn.
Amen.
When he made her our district superintendent at a point in time. And I think that's something to be celebrated. And sometimes our children ought to write about those kinds of things when they need to do reports, when they're trying to figure out who should I write about.
Yes.
You know, sometimes our trailblazers who set an example are not always the ones that sometimes folk look to. So we should remember those things that are important.
Amen.
Let us be in prayer. Heavenly Father, I just thank you and I bless your holy name for allowing me and each and every person here to rise up this morning with health and with strength, feeling compelled to be in your house. Feeling compelled to come and worship and to praise and to give honor to you, Lord. And so, Lord, my prayer is that there would be less of me, Lord, that indeed the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts collectively will be acceptable, will be pleasing to you, Lord. You are our strength. You are our redeemer. We pray this in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. I want to thank the choir. You know, it's easy to be a part of something when you have all the bells and whistles. You got all the instruments.
All right.
You got the director.
All right.
You got robes for different seasons. You know, it's real easy for people to feel like, you know, they really into it. But let me tell you, when God has his hand on you and what you're doing, you don't need all of that. You don't need all of that. And I'm convinced that when it's all up and looking how y'all want it to look, pastors, just Kim, people who wouldn't have thought twice not even once, about being appointed here. Oh, they gonna be wanting to have, because sometimes folk want new and improved and all of that.
Come on.
Oh, but don't be fooled.
Come on.
For your leadership, you be mindful. Mindful that whatever the Lord says, that you have been in communication with him, so that there will not be wolves in sheep clothing or with collars turned around that are coming here for the wrong reason. So just be mindful. That's just Kim's thought on it. I'm just telling you how folk can be. How folk can be. And so this morning, as we kind of just go through, and I'm going to move quickly. It's my goal. To move quickly through this passage of scripture, this Roman scripture that is about judging. Yeah. About people judging.
Come on.
And I know that some folk, you know, they might not have had my road and my journey. It might be some folk here who have never, ever passed judgment on a single solitary soul. you know, some folk, like, you know, some of the people that we just come across in our daily walk, or we hear about, or we know about, I'm sure people don't pass judgments on folks who are pimps, gang members, and child abusers. I'm sure that I'm not just talking about us, but blood-washed believers, people who call themselves followers of Christ, decent, self-respecting United Methodists across the spectrum. You know, you have some folk who, I wonder, do they pass judgment on poor people? Do they pass judgment on female clergy? I'm convinced that sometimes there's a difference even between the way lay folk treat male clergy, pastors, and females. That's just Kim. I'm just saying, just you know, how old folk would say, just keep living. Right. Oh, just keep living and pay attention. Sometimes we pass judgment. Some people have passed judgment and judged elected officials. Like, for example, the governor of Texas. Or the state where my daughter is, Florida. You know, where you have these seemingly unhinged maniacs who are in charge, but more importantly, you have people running to the polls to put these folk in office. Yes. That's just Kim.
Yes.
But so I'm here to let you know that judging does happen.
Yes.
But as I reflected on this and gave a title to what I was going to talk about and speak and teach and preach on, was, but thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. Because the passage of scripture that we read talked about God being righteous in his judgment. It also talked about nobody is going to be excused for their conduct or their behavior. Go back and read it.
That's right.
Now, it talked about the order that things were going to happen, but what was clear is something was going to happen to everybody.
Amen.
It was going to happen to you, even if you said, but I didn't go to Bible study, so I didn't learn any of this. And what the scripture is letting you know is that there's a sense of decency and morality that should be a part of your DNA. So whether or not you attended Bible study, whether you came to church, there's something that should tell you you should not just run around shooting and killing people. You should not just be running around abusing people. You should not be just running around and making decisions because your life is good, that you decide that you don't want anyone else's life to be good. I know that sometimes these things can become sensitive conversation pieces, but if you are indeed a follower of Christ, there are things that you should know within yourself that you can't support an amen and cosign on. It doesn't matter if it doesn't jive, so to speak, with your political perspective, because your political perspective should never trump You don't really like to even say that name sometimes. That's just me. That your political perspective should not trump who you are as one called to be a follower of Christ Jesus. That should never be when you are thinking, when you are contemplating, when you are trying to figure out, should you go to the right or to the left? Should you walk through that wide door or go through that narrow path? That you should think about that in terms of what would Jesus expect of me? Uh-huh. Not what would my bank account or my retirement fund. And I'm not saying that those things are not important and significant in certain ways, but I am saying that should not be your go-to. That should not be where you land each and every time. So here in our scripture, it tells us that in verse 2, now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. So they're letting us know that God's judgment is based on truth.
Amen.
So when you, a mere human being, pass judgment on them and yet do the same thing, do you think you will escape God's judgment? You know, sometimes folk are real quick to criticize, to judge the way someone else does something. For example, people without children, talking about folk with children. Now, we all know that, you know, when you've completely gone off the reservation, you don't need to have children to know when you've completely gone off the reservation. But really, until you have had that experience, until you are the one responsible Amen. For everything about them, you really don't know what that's about.
Amen.
You know, when you have not been in a marriage, now I haven't, but what I do know is while you trying to tell somebody how to handle theirs, they ought to be looking at you wondering, you've got to be kidding me. So we need to be careful about the things that we do. And we ought to be very careful about quickly saying what we would never do. I know that there are some people here who probably their voices even kill all the time. But just like that mama bear who gives out big bear hugs to her baby bears, you mess with one of her young ones, you're talking about raising up on your hind legs. I think, you know, we certainly understand that most parents are going to do that. And those who have grandchildren, oh, they will let you know in a minute. They will let you know in a minute. But what it says to us here is that God will repay each person according to what they have done.
Amen.
To those who by persistence in doing good seek glory, honor, and Amen. Immortality, he will give eternal life.
Yeah.
So this is the road map. It is making it crystal clear what God will do and what you need to do in order to have God make the decision that he's going to make. And then it goes on. But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger. There will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil. First the Jew and then the Gentile. So you don't need to think that you're going to escape in some way. You know, and we know that God gets our attention in many different ways. Me rushing this morning unnecessarily, and I know I'm the only person this probably happens to. So I knew Sunday was coming because I had already spoke to Reverend Kathy. Saturday was here, so I knew it was coming. Already had something hanging up on the hook. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna put that on. Then this morning.
Here we go.
That's right. Here we go. That's right. That was me. Now, why, when it had already been determined, why did I need to even consider or waste my time about what an option would be when there was no need for an option? But, you know, sometimes in our humanness, we can get caught up. So here I am, caught up. Several outfits. You know, and then had plenty of time, but trying to make sure those beans cooked enough so when I got back, so I'm trying to manage the stove. None of that should have been on my radar. None of that, because I had my assignment. I had something to wear. The word of God tells us, don't care about what you eat, what you gonna wear. Now here I am, like I don't know that. Running around, and then ended up back with the same outfit I started with. You know, I know I'm the only one who does stuff like that. But the scripture came to mind very clear. Why was I concerned? Because if he taking care of the birds and the air, if they ain't running around trying to figure stuff, why am I? You know, just didn't make any sense at all. Then the word continues on to tell us all who sin from the law will also perish apart from the law, and all who sin under the law will be judged by the law. For it is not those who hear the law who are righteous in God's sight, but it's those who obey the law who will be declared righteous. Now, I read over that a few times. You know, sometimes you've read scripture, you've been in study, but pretty much what God is saying, all right, you can show up to church, you can proof text and know the scripture, you can do all of that. But almost like Janet Jackson, the Lord is asking us, what have we done for him lately? What are you doing? What are you actually doing? Are you coming just for yourself? Now, I know we all on our way to glory, and we working to make it on in, but you sure would hope and pray that somebody else would be there. You wouldn't want to just be there. Now, I know certainly we're like one of Donnie McClurkin's songs. He said he don't care about Peter. He don't care about Paul, just as long as Jesus is there. And I know that's what we all know. If nobody's there but Jesus and we in the mix, we're good with it. But you really would want to know that somebody else made it in. You want to know your children made it in. You would certainly want to know that your parents made it in, because you'd be saying, oh, no, they're not here. But God is clear. You have to do some things. You can't just know my word. You can't merely just hide it in your heart. You need to make a difference. We have been called and we are set apart. God is going to, in his way, judge us by the things that we say, by the things that we do. And so we need to be mindful of it. I am convinced that some of the challenges that we have, and I don't mean just us as black folk, I don't just mean us as Christians, I think that some of the struggles we face just as people is that our walk and our talk is inconsistent. Yes. Yes. You have signs, and I know I'm the only one who gets annoyed with this. You have signs at the gas station. You got arrows there that tell you which way to come in and out. Yes. And you know, and I'm thinking things, and sometimes they may not be, you know, the most holy. I'm not saying they totally unholy. But, and then we wonder why children and our youth do the things they do. They just sitting watching you break the rules. And you probably consider yourself as an honest, decent, law-abiding person, but you don't want to follow any of these rules about the gas station. Now, that might not be a big deal to somebody. Maybe I go there too often and it annoys me. But if we are not going to live and lead by the example that we should. We don't need to be at all surprised when young folk break rules, don't follow rules, don't want to do anything, because they just looking at you. And they're doing what they see you do. They're saying what they hear you say. I remember doing casework, and, you know, there were young children who would say things, and when you're asking people, well, where did they get that from? Why are they saying that? Where did they hear it? The adults are saying they have no idea. Now, you write it down. You know, they say they have no idea, but you ought to have some idea. Now, sometimes we had a good idea where it was coming from, but, you know, you cannot be surprised. And so we need to let our walk be our walk, and our talk indeed be our talk. That's who we are called to be. And I think the passage of scripture that really is that one to hang on, the verse here, it says, God will look at our record.
Right.
Uh-huh. Our record of how we evidence our faith in obedience to him. That's the record. He will open the book which records everything we have done and said and thought. That should be a little scary, because we know, you know, sometimes they say we fall down, but we do get up. But sometimes, you know, we're not at our best. We're not at our best. That part right there. No, we will not. Did you say that? I don't remember. Will you be proud of what the book says about you?
Amen.
Okay. Perhaps some, but oh. I'm here to tell you, I thank God for Jesus, because I'm sure that there are some very shameful things in each and every one of our lives that have been recorded. None of us will be able to stand spotless. All of us will have to say guilty about one or more things. But we're just thankful that God, through the blood of Jesus, has erased and removed our sin, our judgment, our shortcomings, our hard hearts, our failure to take care of those like widows, orphans, the poor, and really the list goes on. You just name it. And as I was reflecting and thinking about the list going on about how God is forgiving and loving for our shortcomings, I think about the great country that we live in has some shortcomings. We need not even pretend or imagine that it does not. But a country that is sending millions and billions in goods, services, and money across the water to help some people get out of their situation reminds me of when the campaign, and Bernie Sanders told folk, oh, you know, we ought to be able to send all our kids to college. And there was some naysayers. We can't afford to do that. All I know is by the time they finish hitting the 10 key on what it's costing to help with this war, I honestly believe that we could have. Now, clearly, the budget for America is something that we can't conceive of, and I'm sure the average person who said, no, we can't do it, didn't have any idea of how much money America truly has. Now we're helping, as we should, with this devastation, with this earthquake. But it also says we could do more and better for ourselves as well, for the people here. So while folks are naysayers saying what can't be done, all we know is the cattle on a thousand hills belong to our Father. And that he would not withhold any good thing. And so sometimes we need to press and lean in on some things. And so it is because we do indeed thank God for Jesus, because We are given grace. We are given forgiveness. We are given mercy for our many, many shortcomings. Because left up to each and every one of us, and I don't really have to look far. I can just go and look in the mirror at myself and just come up with the Britannica. Some people may not know what that is, but we used to have the encyclopedias in the little bookcase, and every year, you know, one came. I could probably fill up a volume or two on some of my shortcomings, and boy, if I was in charge of judgment and forgiveness for all, oh yeah, I could fill them up. I could fill them up. But thank God it is Jesus. Thank God that it is our Heavenly Father who is the righteous judge and gives us a roadmap and reminds us that we could really never, ever be worthy of the forgiveness. We just couldn't. Whether it's driving on the freeway, and you know, people can really get you sometime a little uptight, particularly if you made yourself late. Now you had a nerve to be mad at everybody who's in your way. And I know it's just me. And so you can be uptight about that. Now, I might be the only person here who's eating eggs. You can be uptight going into the store looking at the price of eggs. And while we've gotten distracted with that, you look at those numbers at that gas station again creeping up. You know, so if I was issuing out judgment on the oil companies and all of that, it might not look so good, you know, for them. You know, if I was that, if I was the person managing these over those who manage these high interest rates and carrying on, and that property is putting people into poverty with its prices, you know, I'm sure God is saying I couldn't trust her with that much power and responsibility ever. I thank God for Jesus because, as the song reminds us, I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. Can you imagine that you were down there and you didn't even think you could get up? But the master of the sea, peace be still is what he said to the winds and the waves. He heard my despairing cry from the waters, lifted me. Now safe am I. Love lifted me, and Jesus is love. Lionel Richie and the Commodores had a song about it. Jesus is love. I know. And if you ask, this is Jesus telling you, I'll show. Love is the way. Sickness had your body and you thought you would not get well. But thank God for Jesus. Loved ones have left. And you didn't know if you would make it. You knew the Lord. You knew you trusted him. But oh, you struggled. You were challenged by it. Oh, but thank God for Jesus. COVID came. It still lingers. It has taken lives. It has done so many things. Oh, but thank God for Jesus. Fire at your church. But you still out here praising the Lord, having meetings, making stuff happen, doing what people who are called by Christ to do, that they do, that you just gonna serve. Because somebody wished they had a parking lot. Somebody wished they had a parking lot and some tents and some chairs and some microphones and all of that. Somebody would love to be in the shoes of St. John regardless. And so we thank God for Jesus. Job reminds us that though he slay me, yet will I trust him. So it doesn't matter what happens. We're going to trust God. Systems and institutions. Racism running rampant. Racism running so rampant in systems that we would have five black men beating on another black man, which tells you it's not about color, it is about systems that perpetuate that and have folk drawn into it and believing that they should function in very barbaric and inhumane ways, but we pray and we thank God for Jesus because the camera in the background was allowed to be in there so truth could shine, so that truth could indeed shine. And we thank God for Jesus. We know indeed that what the devil intends for good, for evil, God always intends for good. And so we can say thank God for Jesus. That's something that should carry you on, that you can just press on through, that you can make it a little further, because you can stop and say thank God for Jesus. Red light catch you, you running late, but you can say, I'm in my car, I'm safe. All I have to do is wait for the light to change. And so I thank God for Jesus that in these situations and circumstances that I have a Savior who I can go to. I have a Savior who, in spite of all of my shortcomings, that he offers me grace, and that when he indeed judges me, he judges me in righteousness. And when I don't judge others in righteousness, he still loves me. And so we are thankful that we have a God who indeed loves us, a God who cares for us. And so I want to know, is anybody here? Are you thankful for Jesus? Are you thankful for Jesus? Amen, amen. So continue to praise him. Continue to press on. Continue to know that God has not forgotten about you. Whatever isn't happening yet with the building, we don't need to be worried about that. We know it is in God's hands. Because we have systems and structures in place where within God's power, within God's spirit, we hold folks accountable for that. We're thankful that insurance is available and at hand. Because somebody's stuff burned down and didn't have anything. And so we thank God. We thank God for all of those things. And so I just want to encourage you, continue meeting on this corner, because the word says little becomes much.
Say it.
Little becomes much. There are plenty of examples of little becoming much. I don't know if folk remember, but I remember when Faithful Central was on Hoover. Right off of Gage.
Yeah, that's right.
And look at them now. I don't think God's running short on blessings at all, anywhere. There are plenty of places where that was the case. Hoover off of Manchester. Pastor McKnight was there at a point, and now that's the church over there in Gardena, that's on Main Street. Has indeed grown. Yes. Yes. Pastor Noel Jones, or Bishop Noel Jones, or yes. Started out as something else. And look at how you just stayed a course, and you know that indeed God is able.
Yes.
God is able. God is indeed able. And we thank God for Jesus. Amen and amen.
Speak victory.
Depression.